Wow, that was sort of scary. Well, all I can say is I'll try to avoid alternative facts, if nothing else. Yeah, that's very, very kind, Kelsey. I think I've gotten to an age where all of my friends have become deans, and I don't get to see them as often as I like. So that's, it was very nice. All right, so my lab, as was mentioned, I think we're interested in the kind of the classical molecular biology question of how cells regulate the protein output of genes. But rather than where one often thinks about this problem at the initiation of the transcription reaction and the beginning of the synthesis of an RNA from a particular gene, we're interested in all the different molecular transactions that occur with that information once it's become an RNA, and all the different kinds of reactions that occur that are going to adjust how that RNA is used and what protein it encodes, and so on. And so the reaction that we're most focused on, and the most complex reaction, is the pre-mRNA splicing reaction. And so, as in its simplest case, the splicing reaction can be altered to produce different proteins through the use of different splice sites, or in the simplest case, what's called a cassette exon, where an exon can be spliced into the mRNA or skipped depending on the conditions. And what this will normally do is alter the protein coding of that mRNA. It can also alter the overall gene expression, but it mostly it will add a small bit of peptide sequence into a protein and somehow alter its activity. What this actually does to the protein it depends entirely on what gene you're looking at. So these exons can alter the ligand binding properties of growth factor receptors, or they can add a phosphorylation site to allow regulation by different signaling pathways. It's very common to see cell adhesion regulated through the use of these different isoforms or membrane properties and ion channels can often be tuned in this way through this inclusion or exclusion of different kinds of exons or different segments of RNA. So this is actually, reaction actually or this kind of regulation is particularly common in the mammalian nervous system, but it really is seen in all cell types in almost all metazoan organisms. So this is actually quite an old slide that predates the genome sequence. And what next-gen sequencing has told us is that this kind of regulation is really more the rule than the exception, that virtually all mammalian genes produce more than one protein product through the use of this kind of alternative splicing reaction. And so this is kind of a random example I stole from Yixing, showing the transcripts that are produced as annotated by the UCSC genome browser from the delta catenin gene is just sort of a typical example whereby one can see that the bars are exons and they can be included or skipped in different combinations to produce this large family of related proteins but with different activities. And so that this delta catenin, at least as of this date, makes about 30 different isoforms. That's a little bit more than average, but not unusual. So these choices about making a particular isoform or not can be extremely tightly regulated and regulated really at the level of individual cells. So this is also an old slide of very old examples of splicing patterns that differ between individual neuronal subtypes. This is my example that I particularly like is in the snail limnea, where the gene for the furmurfamid peptide, which controls heartbeat, among other things in the snail, is encoded on a particular splice transcript. And that same gene produces mRNAs for other peptides through the use of changing the pattern of splicing in that mRNA. And if one probes, if you section through a ganglion here, where each of these is a separate neuron, and probe for either the furmurfamid exon or one of these other exons, you see that certain neurons are making this splice variant in other neurons are making the other. So this kind of regulation can be very precisely regulated by cell type. There are similar and similarly old examples in mammals as well. So that's sort of the problem, that the cell can make a choice about a splicing pattern. And we're very interested in how it can do that. And that question comes down to a question of the spliceosome and what's determining where it's going to assemble. So as everyone knows, that pre-mRNAs are divided into exons and introns, and the introns are defined by special sequences at the ends, the splice sites, and those assemble the spliceosomal complex that's going to carry out the catalysis or removal of each of these introns. And so that happens in an ordered way where there's the U1 snRNP will bind to the 5' splice site, the 3' splice site's recognized by a special protein, the U2AF factor, to form an early complex, and that's joined by the U2 snRNP, the base pairs at the branch point to make a pre-spliceosome, and then that's joined by 5 more snRNPs and to make the large spliceosome complex that contains the 5 snRNAs and over 100 proteins. And that's only the beginning. Now, this whole complex undergoes these very complicated rearrangements where particular snRNPs are ejected and the splice sites are assembled into a catalytic center involving the U2 and the U6 snRNAs that will ultimately carry out the chemical steps of splicing, the 2 transesterification reactions that result in the ligation of the 2 exons and the release of the intron in this interesting lariat structure. So all of that has to happen on each intron that's going to be removed from the pre-mRNA. And there's hundreds of components of this complex. Probably all of them are regulated in some way. Most of the understanding of the regulation of splicing, of what's going to determine whether a splice site is going to end up in that catalytic center or not, has focused on the early steps in the reaction, and particularly on specialized RNA binding proteins that bind to the pre-mRNA and somehow alter the assembly of the spliceosome. So there's a very large number of these proteins. It's looking like more than 500, perhaps more than 1,000 in mammalian genomes. And they act, there's many different structural families. They act in different ways. They can act positively to stimulate assembly and recognition of particular sites. They can act negatively to prevent recognition of particular sites. And the same protein actually can act either positively or negatively, depending on where it binds. Okay, so in our lab, we're focused on two sort of general kinds of questions regarding these RNA binding proteins. The first are very mechanistic questions of trying to understand how they interact with the pre-mRNA and how they interact with the spliceosome to ultimately alter its assembly. And then over time, we've identified a number of these proteins that are important for regulating particular splicing patterns in the nervous system. And so that's enabled us to go and look at some of the biology of these factors and try to understand what role they might be playing either in neuronal development or in the function of mature neuronal cells. So again, this is a simplification, and with genome-wide analyses, whole transcriptome analyses, the picture gets much more complex, where it's clear that exons are generally regulated by many different factors, multiple factors. Each factor will regulate a whole large set of exons, with each exon being regulated by multiple factors. And this makes the genetics of these factors difficult. And it's interesting to think about. It's also known now that these RNA binding proteins regulate their own expression and each other's expression post-transcriptionally. And so it's interesting to think about this kind of layer of regulation that's largely separate from the transcription reaction, and think about it in relation to neuropsychiatric disease or cancer biology. There's also examples of that where a perturbation in one of these factors can propagate through the network, not only on its own targets, but through indirect effects onto other targets, creating changes in the overall expression pattern from cells that can be quite difficult to see if you're just looking at the overall expression from genes at the transcription reaction itself, that one needs to be looking at really fine details of what isoforms are being expressed. Okay, so our work in this with these questions started out studying just one exon, the N1 exon in the SARC transcript, and this was a nice model system to start with in that it was a very tightly regulated, simple change in splicing, where the N1 exon is spliced into the SARC mRNA only in neurons, and it's almost 100% spliced in neurons. And then it skipped in all other cells. And so over time, we identified many features that go into sustaining this regulation that are in the cis-acting elements in the RNA and proteins that recognize those elements. And so the simple answer to the regulation at this point is really that these kinds of alternative exons assemble different RNP complexes depending on the cell type you're in, the cellular environment, and so on. And so we found that the N1 exon is under both negative regulation in non-neuronal cells and positive regulation in neurons. And this turns out to be a common feature of these highly tissue-specific exons. And the key protein for repression of the exon in non-neuronal cells is this PTBP1 protein. But in neurons, things get more complicated. The PTBP1 is downregulated and replaced with a close homolog called PTBP2. And PTBP2 is interesting in that it binds to similar sequences but in the exon, but doesn't repress the splicing of the exon. And then also in neurons, there's a downstream enhancer sequence that becomes more active, and the key protein for stimulating splicing of the exon are these family of proteins called RBFOX proteins. Okay, so I usually talk about the PTB proteins or the RBFOX proteins. I think I most recently spoke about the PTB proteins in the cancer center, so today I thought I'd talk about the RBFOX proteins. The PTB proteins, in some ways, are we understand better that particularly the repression by the PTBP1 and the mechanism of that, and also its biological role in that this transition from PTBP1 to 2 occurs very early in neuronal differentiation and is accompanied by a large-scale transition in the expression of spliced isoforms that are specific to the developing neurons. And then PTBP2 controls a second transition later in neuronal maturation. RBFOX, we've studied more from the point of view of its function within mature neurons. And so this project has been worked on by a great group of people over the years, both past and present, and as well as a large number of UCLA collaborators that have been really essential for us in trying to pursue some of the neuroscience related to the RBFOX proteins, as well as the proteomics and the bioinformatics. And so currently in the lab, this is the current RBFOX project. And today I'm going to talk about work from Andre Damiano's lab. He's a biochemist. He's been working on the RBFOX interacting proteins. And Yi Ying, who's found some very interesting physical features of the RBFOX protein that I'll talk about at the end. Zhaojun Wang is a biochemist who's going to continue some of that stuff. And then bioinformatics is all done by Beverly Lin in the lab, and I'll talk briefly about a new sort of neuroscience aspect of the RBFOX proteins and one of its targets that Celine Wang has found, and we're very interested in relation to the role of RBFOX in neurons. Okay, so this project is sort of close to my heart because it started out with the very first regulatory sequence I identified as a postdoc for splicing, and I found that there was a mutation that the N1 exon would be spliced into a message in a neuroblastoma cell line and not in a HeLa cell line. And if you mutated this sequence downstream from the exon, that eliminated splicing of the exon. And so over the years, this element has been worked on by a number of people. It was particularly well defined by Gene Hu and Richard Hines' lab as being the element UGCAUG. And work from a number of labs have characterized it bioinformatically and identified proteins that bind to it. And I think that the key result came from Kunio Inoue's lab in Japan, who found that a zebrafish protein that was related to the C. elegans protein FOX1, or feminizing locus on X, bound very specifically to this UGC-AUG element. And so that told us that was the family of regulators to look at for this sequence. And we and a number of other groups have found that this protein indeed regulates a large number of neuronal specific exons and other exons. And it has this interesting property that's been found in other splicing regulators, where if it binds downstream from an exon, it tends to stimulate splicing, whereas if it binds upstream from an exon, it usually represses splicing. So this is interesting both mechanistically and biologically. And these proteins are very highly conserved. They're really present in all metazoan organisms, I think, where in humans or in mammals, there are three genes, three paralogs, that are extremely similar. They have a central RNA binding domain, or RM type domain, as well as N and C terminal domains. And the RM domain is essentially identical between FOX1, FOX2, and FOX3 in mammals, and it's 75% identical even with the worm protein. And so this domain was solved by NMR bound to the UGC-AUG element, and by Fred Allen's lab, and he showed that it engages in an unusual interaction with the RNA for an RRM and makes extensive contacts across that whole element that gives it this very specific interaction for this particularly this hexanucleotide. The pentanucleotide also works. So we have a fairly simple looking protein with a single RRM, two auxiliary domains. That's until you look at the genes. And the genes are sort of a nightmare. They're the RBFOX1 gene in humans is 2.5 megabases long, has 5 promoters, and it has extensive alternative splicing to give it different isoforms. RBFOX2 is a little shorter, and RBFOX3, also called new N. But they also have multiple promoters and multiple sites of alternative splicing. And so today, I'm going to talk about a couple of different kinds of isoforms from the FOX1 gene. There's a change in splicing at the 3' end that gives it different C termini, and that determines whether the protein will be nuclear or cytoplasmic. And the same thing happens in 2 and 3. And then at the end, I'll be talking about isoforms that change depending on the use of this B40 exon or the M43 exon that give it two different insertions into the C-terminal domain. So these genes, they're complex. They also show complex patterns of expression. And in the brain, most neurons express all three. But there are differences. So this is just FOX1 and FOX2 in different sections. And so you can see, for example, in layer 4 of the cortex, they make FOX2, but less FOX1. And then the really striking differences are in the cerebellum, where the granule cells are making FOX1, Purkinje cells make FOX1, whereas FOX2 is not in the granule cells, but in molecular layer cells, as also in the Purkinje cells. So there are these very complex patterns of regulation in different neuronal subtypes. All right. So Lauren Gaiman in the lab wanted to take a genetic approach to look at the role of these proteins in the brain, and she made the typical floxed alleles to allow conditional knockout, and she knocked out the FOX1 gene in all the neurons of the developing brain with a standard Nestin-Cree line. She found that the mice were born, they looked relatively normal, though they were small, and their brains were largely anatomically normal. We couldn't find very many differences between the wild type and the knockout. Even with no FOX1 present, there was an upregulation of FOX2, interestingly. But in looking at these mice, Lauren found noticed that they were prone to having spontaneous seizures, not very frequent, but noticeable. And she could stain and see that these were fairly typical looking with entorhinal cortex into the hippocampus being excited as by CFOS staining. And so this was quite interesting for us because of a number of reports in the literature, both before this and since, that implicated mutations in FOX1, also called A2BP1 in humans, in both familial epileptic disorders and in autism spectrum disorders. I think most strongly in a recent paper from Dan Geschwin's lab here, showing that looking at the transcriptomes of autistic brains compared to wild type, and they found indeed that there were decreases in RBFOX1 expression and changes in RBFOX-dependent splicing in autistic brain relative to normal. All right, so we were quite interested in this phenotype of and how it might develop. The difficulty with splicing factor knockout mice is that they have a lot of targets, and in fact we found many different changes in splicing across the knockout brains, but particularly we found lots of changes in transcripts encoding ion channels, neurotransmitter receptors, things involved in calcium dynamics, synaptic transmission, and so on. And many of these, things like the NMDA receptor or SNAP25, the snare protein, had previously been implicated in various kinds of seizure disorders. And analyses of SNAP25 mutant mice that shift the splicing in a similar pattern also got seizures. So that was very interesting. We were also interested in the fact that it seemed that there were fewer changes in this RBFOX1 knockout mice than one might see with some other splicing regulators. And we think that's due to compensation by the other RBFOX proteins. There was that upregulation of RBFOX2. But importantly, that the FOX2 mice that I won't be talking about, they don't exhibit a seizure phenotype. So there is something very specific about FOX1 in this particular phenotype. And so we're very focused on the splicing changes in these mice and what they might be doing. But Jian Li, a student with me who went to do a postdoc in Kelsey's lab, knew that a large amount of RBFOX protein is cytoplasmic, and he wanted to look at the role of the cytoplasmic RBFOX proteins. And so in Kelsey's lab, he set up a very nice assay for separating these two functions, where he took hippocampal neurons in culture and knocked down FOX1 and FOX3, here just showing the FOX1, and then he re-expressed via AAV either the cytoplasmic isoform of RBFOX1 or the nuclear isoform of RBFOX1. And he could show, here's the SNAP25 gene again, here's the two exons that are used, either the upstream or the downstream one, the untreated cells, this is now by RNA-seq, where the peak height is about half the constitutive height, so these are being used at about 50% one or the other. When he knocks down, it activates the upstream one and suppresses the downstream one. He re-expresses just the nuclear isoform of FOX1, and reverses the splicing and rescues the splicing of this downstream exon, which turns out to be positively regulated by RBFOX. So the nuclear protein was changing the splicing, but Jian went on to look at the cytoplasmic protein, and he found, interestingly, that he could separate the splicing changes that responded from the changes in overall expression from different genes, and the splicing changes were indeed reverted by the nuclear FOX protein and much less so by the cytoplasmic, whereas the expression changes, it changes in overall RNA level from the gene, they were not reversed by the nuclear isoform, but they were reversed by the cytoplasmic isoform. And so analyzing these genes, it was quite interesting. We found many of the same splicing changes that we already knew about, regulated by the nuclear isoform. But the genes that were regulated by the cytoplasmic isoform were in the same functional categories. They did very similar things. So we have GRIN1 over here in splicing and GRIN2 over here being affected for expression and so on, CAM kinase 2A, CAM kinase 2D. But they were largely separate. So there seemed to be two arms of this complicated regulatory pathway, one in the cytoplasm and one in the nucleus, that were regulating common functions but different genes. So Jian went on and looked at, well, these genes that are regulated at the level of overall RNA level, they have binding by RBFOX1 in their 3' UTR. So this is the CAMK2 alpha 3' UTR. Jian and Andrei Damianov did the iClip assay to look at genome-wide binding of RBFOX1 across the transcriptome in these cells. And what this does is you IP the proteins that have been cross-linked to RNA, and then you sequence the little fragments that were attached. And each of these little dashes is a sequenced RNA that was attached to an RBFOX protein. They pile up in particular regions along this 3' UTR. And so that was very nice, and that now we have the overall expression is being affected by the RBFOX1 binding in the 3' UTR. And so Jian showed that indeed the FOX binding sites in the 3' UTR using a luciferase were required for that upregulation from the cytoplasmic isoform, whereas the nuclear isoform doesn't affect these luciferase constructs. And so cutting to the chase, the picture is that the RBFOX protein binds in the 3' UTRs of these transcripts and stimulates their translation and also increases their stability. And that seems to have two different effects. So in some cases, it looks like the RBFOX1 is interfering with microRNA binding sites and thereby preventing downregulation by a microRNA. But there seem to be other sites where there's not an obvious microRNA involved, and there seems to be some direct stimulation of expression from RBFOX1. So Jian is pursuing this part of the problem and how that activation might occur in Kelsey's lab. And Celine Wong in the lab was very interested in this process, and in particular this large list of very interesting genes that were being regulated in the cytoplasm. And she focused on this one, VAMP1. And so this is sort of a quick aside about this project that's ongoing, but I wanted to mention it because Celine's found some really interesting things related to the FOX1 regulatory protein in this project. And so she found that the VAMP1 gene, so this is a snare protein that's very similar to the better known VAMP2 or synaptobrevin protein, and VAMP1 is strongly downregulated in the RBFOX1 knockout. It has the CLIP sites in its 3' UTR. You can see the downregulation of the RNA as well as the protein in the RNA-seq. But what she's found is that VAMP1, unlike VAMP2, is specifically expressed in parvalbumin positive interneurons, so inhibitory neurons, and it's not expressed in excitatory neurons. So you can see that here where it's co-staining with the GAD presynaptic inhibitory marker and not overlapping with VGLUT and excitatory marker. And so we're very interested in this. Celine is collaborating with Weijing Wei in Tom O'Dell's lab to look at the effects of this on physiology. And Weijing has recently found that depletion of VAMP1 like this leads to decreased frequency in iPSC in miniature iPSC and EPSC currents. And so that we're interested in that because it's similar to what's also seen in the RBFOX1 knockout hippocampus. And so they're working hard to sort of understand that physiological effect. Celine has shown that the VAMP1 regulation by FOX1 is through the 3' UTR, and it seems to be interfering with a MER9-mediated repression. So I think this is interesting because it's saying that really we've been thinking of RBFOX as being in most neurons, and that it has this regulatory program that's affecting all these different gene products that are found in a lot of different neurons. This product, since it seems to be specific to interneurons, is saying that it's going to be more complicated than that, and we're going to have to think about specific targets in specific cells. All right. So that's sort of a whirlwind tour through the biology. What we have is an intricate program of many different targets of these proteins. Some of them are cytoplasmic, regulated at the level of translation. Some of them are nuclear, regulated at the level of splicing. And these targets include many different ion channels, neurotransmitter receptors, and so on. I forgot to mention that nearly the whole calcium signaling pathway, particularly on the cytoplasmic regulation, seems to be all the chem kinase, and so on, are regulated by RBFOX binding to the 3' UTR. And so we're interested in how one might correlate this with the fact that the deletion of RBFOX1 leads to this hyperexcitation phenotype, and how these different changes in transcripts affect that circuit level activity. And so that's something that we're interested in. Now we're looking at both excitatory and inhibitory transmission in that regard. And then I haven't told, these are older stories about what the RBFOX2 protein does when it's knocked out and other aspects of RBFOX biology that I haven't spoken about, because I wanted to go on and talk a little bit about some newer data related to how RBFOX regulates splicing. And so these, as you saw, that there are many different exons that are regulated by these at the level of splicing. Two that we've used as we've studied a lot and we've used as sort of models are in the L-type calcium channel transcript, CACNA1C. And so this is a typical voltage-gated calcium channel, and it has many different alternative exons that some of which we've studied, some we haven't, that are all regulated in different ways. And so there are two RBFOX-dependent exons in this channel. The exon 9 star is in this intracellular domain, and exon 33 is adjacent to the voltage sensor over here in domain 4. And these are regulated, interestingly, in opposite directions by the RBFOX proteins. This was all done by Zhenji Tang, a postdoc in the lab, who came from a calcium channel lab and wanted to look at this splicing. And so exon 9 star actually has three different possible FOX binding sites, UGC, AUG. It turns out only the upstream one is active, and being an upstream element, that is repressed, that makes the exon repressed by FOX. So if we express, it's normally fully included exon 9 star in this reporter gene, but then it's repressed as you increase the FOX1 expression. Exon 33 is the reverse. It has a single downstream element, and it's usually not included in the transcript from the reporter, but as you express FOX protein, now that stimulates splicing of that exon. And so interestingly, that these two changes in splicing have similar effects on the activity of the channel, that both of them, either skipping exon 9 star or including exon 33, both shift the current voltage relationship of the channel to the left, allowing it to gate at lower voltage for physiological reasons that are not known. Okay, so those are sort of exons, fairly typical exons for that regulated by RBFOX. And Andre Damianoff in the lab wanted to start looking at this regulation more closely, and he started out with doing a genome-wide analysis of RBFOX binding across the transcriptome, but he added a twist to this in that he fractionated, after cross-linking, he fractionated the nuclei into two fractions, the soluble fraction and then the pellet fraction that contains all of the chromatin. And all of the introns, all the unspliced RNA, tends to pellet with chromatin. And he found interesting difference in where FOX was binding in these two fractions. So it's binding in the introns in this fraction. That's not surprising because that's where the introns are. The 3' UTR, though, is present equally in the two fractions, and it seems to be binding FOX more in the soluble fraction than in the pellet fraction. And so this is now, again, the SNAP25 transcript. Here are the two exons, with the downstream one has these downstream FOX binding sites that stimulate its splicing. And this brings up a question that's always been sort of an issue with RBFOX, is that the UGC-AUG element is quite short. There's many copies of it in the transcriptome, and there are sites across the RNA that are not bound by the RBFOX, whereas some of them are bound by RBFOX. And so this was one question that we think we've answered or started to answer from Andre's work. And so what Andre wanted to do was to ask, well, what are the protein-protein interactions with RBFOX in that chromatin fraction where the protein that's regulating splicing resides? And so he worked out a method for extracting the proteins out of these two fractions, the soluble and the high molecular weight, by treating them with nuclease to get rid of all the DNA and the RNA and release the proteins. And he found that by looking at these two fractions that most of the RBFOX protein was going into this high molecular weight fraction. And that was a different pattern than one sees with some other kinds of splicing regulators. NOVA, for example, is more in the soluble fraction. PTB is about even. And so he took this fraction and now in an HEK line with a flag tag FOX and isolated the tagged RBFOX proteins and found that, in fact, in that fraction specifically, the RBFOX purified with a very specific set of other proteins that were very close to stoichiometric, or remarkably close given how simple the purification is with the RBFOX itself. And so those proteins were some of them were well-known splicing regulators, and so we've called this a large assembly of splicing regulators, or LASER. So the RBFOX protein is interacting with this large complex, and we wanted to know, well, is some of the RBFOX binding some of these proteins and other RBFOX binding other proteins? In fact, if we now put a tag on one of the other components, that's now overexpressed, but it pulls down the same set of proteins, again, in about equal stoichiometry, so it looks like there is one complex that's all associated with the RBFOX protein. And so that complex includes a whole set of proteins that are been studied in many different contexts, but they're all known splicing regulators. In one sense or another, and particularly this group here have been particularly well characterized for their effects on splicing. And so the question was, well, you know, what's the functional significance of this interaction of this group of proteins with RBFOX? And so one question that came up was this question of, well, is there something different about the binding sites where the UGC-AUG elements where RBFOX is binding from those where it's not binding? And so Andre and Beverly Lynn in the lab characterized all the different cross-link sites and the sites of no cross-linking across their CLIP data and found that adjacent to the sites of RBFOX cross-linking, there was an enrichment of elements, these UG, UGU, and GU, GUG, are binding elements for this HNRMPM protein. And so we think that this is one explanation for why RBFOX is binding at certain sites and not others, is that it's using this regulation with this, this recognition with other proteins that it's interacting with. So Andre also went on and looked at how FOX might affect the activity of M-dependent exons, and he found that in genome-wide analyses of splicing, that exons that are shifted in their splicing by HNRMPM showed smaller shifts and were less affected, sometimes dramatically so, when FOX was absent, and showed stronger shifts when FOX was present. Similarly, if you put an M site in an exon itself in a reporter gene, that M site causes repression of splicing to some extent, but it shows very strong repression of splicing when RBFOX is expressed on top of it in a manner that's dependent on that M site. So FOX seems to be regulating this M-dependent exon through the M site, indicating that this FOX-M interaction is significant. So then, Yi Ying in the lab, a student in the lab, was interested in this interaction between RBFOX and the laser complex, and so she started to pick apart what features are in the FOX protein itself were needed for that interaction. And so she started with simple deletions of the different domains, and she found that you didn't need either the N-terminal domain or the RNA binding domain to pull down the laser complex and all of its proteins. But if you deleted the C-terminal domain, you lost all of those interactions, and the C-terminal domain by itself would interact with all of them and pull down all of them. So that was very nice, and she went on to show that using these two reporters, that both splicing repression of exon 9 star required that C-terminal domain and presumably that interaction with laser, as well as, repression of 9 star or activation of exon 33. Both of them required the interaction with the laser complex for that splicing activity. All right, so now is when things got a little strange, and it started with an observation of Andre's that when he looked using glycerol gradients at these where the proteins were in size from this high molecular weight fraction, he'd probe for the different components of RBFOX and the laser complex, he found that the RBFOX associated, virtually all the RBFOX is associated with the laser complex, and that is sedimenting at about 55S in this broad peak. Similarly, all of the components of the laser complex were in those fractions, but there was also a unit laser complex that was sedimenting up here and still containing the same components except the RBFOX protein. And that is more the size of a single copy of each of the proteins. 55S is much too large for a single copy of each of those proteins. Other splicing regulators don't show this behavior. And so Yi was analyzing was interested in this higher order assembly of these proteins. And so she was analyzing the different RBFOX splice variants. And in particular, she was looking at the difference between the B40 isoform and the M43, which are mutually exclusive exons into the C-terminal domain. And she found that the RBFOX2 M43 isoform failed to have or largely didn't show this higher order assembly and instead sedimented near the top of the gradient as a single complex with the laser proteins. Looking at this exon, so the RBFOX1, B40, and M43 were as we'd seen before. RBFOX2, B40 was as we'd seen before. But this M43 exon was different in that it was missing three tyrosine residues that were in the other exons. This one's missing one. And so she went on to look at these tyrosine residues, and this C-terminal domain is very rich in tyrosines, and so she progressively mutated those tyrosines and found that indeed the tyrosines were essential for this higher order assembly, and that by mutating them either to serine or alanine, they shifted up in the gradient. Mutating them to phenylalanine didn't have much of an effect, so it seems like it's an aromatic interaction of some kind. And interestingly, all of these tyrosine mutants still bound the laser complex, so it's still pulling down all the same proteins, but it's somehow preventing, the mutation in the tyrosine is preventing some kind of higher order assembly of the RBFOX laser unit complex. Interestingly, these mutants had different effects than just deleting the CTD. So expressing these in cells with the reporter genes, she found that the tyrosine mutant still repressed exon 9 star, so you didn't need the higher order assembly for repression, but the exon 33 was not activated by the tyrosine mutant, indicating that for this exon, you needed that higher order assembly to see the regulation. And so the reason for being interested in this is that these properties have been seen before in other contexts, and that is that there's a lot of interest now in RNA binding proteins that have these disordered domains that form higher order assemblies, and in particular they often form amyloid-like fibers. It's been most studied in the fuzz protein that's mutated in certain forms of ALS, and both the McKnight and the Czech labs have studied how this domain that's very rich in GYS and SYG, GYG peptides forms, can aggregate in solution, and it's thought to be important in some of the intracellular inclusions seen in ALS. And so our domain, while it doesn't have, it's not as, have as many SYGs as fuzz, it has very similar looking di and tripeptides across it. And so these kinds of domains, these disordered domains, have been studied in a number of different ways. In vitro, they form hydrogels. If you concentrate them in solution, you can see them undergo liquid-liquid phase separation by microscopy, by treating solutions of them with high salt or with PEG and so on. And they've been seen in the EM to form amyloid-like fibrils, first shown here in David Eisenberg's lab and largely studied here, that they have shown that the fuzz aggregates form this cross-beta amyloid-like structure in their fibrils. Now, in vivo, the relationship of these assays to these in vitro assays to in vivo function is less clear. It's been studied in relation to cytoplasmic stress granules, this kind of aggregation, and as I mentioned, that the protein aggregates in ALS and other neurodegenerative disorders are thought to be involve formation of these amyloid-like fibrils. So Yi has been studying this, and she's found that indeed, if she takes just the fragment of the CTD that has those 10 tyrosines, she can see it form these fibrous aggregates in solution, whereas the mutant doesn't. Those aggregates are stainable with thioflavin T. It's sometimes used as an assay for beta amyloid-like structures, but that needs to be confirmed. And indeed, in the EM, they're forming these interesting fibrils. So to end on what we're really most interested in but don't understand yet, what she's found, I think what's interesting for us is that these aggregation properties are mostly studied either biochemically in solution or as part of these disease processes, and their actual biological function in a typical protein isn't really clear. And so we're excited that this might give us an assay for what kinds of interactions are functionally important in the normal action of the RBFOX protein. And so to extend this, Yi has been has now looked at a large number of exons using her her tyrosine mutants and using an assay for splicing called RazzleSeq, and she finds, and indeed, that they do group differently, that there's that there are a group of exons that are repressed by RBFOX, and they're largely still repressed by the tyrosine mutant, whereas activated exons, activated by RBFOX, some of those are still activated by the tyrosine mutant, but a large number of them are not activated, and so it seems to be that we can pick apart the function of this domain through analyses of its activity in splicing. And so, just to conclude, this is sort of a work in progress slide that the FOX protein is acting through its interaction with a large assembly of other splicing regulators. We actually think that RBFOX, its function may be mainly just to recruit this complex to the RNA. Yi has some data to suggest that. And we're very interested in what these different components do and how they interact with each other, particularly this helicase protein, what it might be, why you might need to recruit it to regulate splicing. We're very interested in the RNA interactions within this complex. Most of these proteins have very specific RNA binding domains, and well, it seems that M and FOX bind together, but what happens to the other, do other proteins? Is there some order of binding sites along an RNA that these are going to interact with? And then there's all these questions related to this higher order assembly. So what is the actual nature of this? We have a lot of fun conversations with the Eisenberg lab about how we might show that is an amyloid-like structure or not. And what we really don't have, we're working hard on it now, is what really, we see this aggregation behavior in solution, but is there some kind of, what's the biological correlate for that? What's the intercellular, what does it mean relative to what FOX is doing in the intranuclear environment? Can we see differences in its localization and so on within the nuclei of cells, depending on those tyrosines? Okay, and so I think I've gone too long, and I've mentioned all the people as I went along, I'll just leave this slide up there. I would like to say that all of our work has been hugely supported by this great community of people at UCLA, and particularly in the neuroscience community, that people are so helpful. We've interacted with, I think, half of the neuroscience community at UCLA with one project or another that really has given us entree into a field and a world that really isn't our specialty. And I'll stop there and take questions.